It doesn't feel good. But we need to just take solace in the fact that even though it may not feel good right now, as long as I'm in his hands, I know that every...
Hey, Hun Buns. This is your girl, Miss Books, to you. Coming to you today with day... Father God, what's today? Day four. And day four is the prayer of Jabez. So my takeaway was, I went to my eye doctor today. Y'all don't care about this. But I went to the eye doctor today, and they dilated my eyes so I can't see. I'm trying not to look directly in the, in the kennel, because I know it gives that reflection. So it says, and though money would have helped my situation in some regards, my life needed more than that. And I think at some point and sometimes in our life, I know we all say, well, not a lot of people might not say, but I know I have said it before, and I've heard other people say, you know, if I won the lottery or if I got a bunch of money, my life would be much easier. But that's not true, because we see people all the time that have large sums of money and they aren't genuinely happy. Like, they get the money, even the lottery winners, they get the money and they spend up the money, because some people equate things to happiness. And I think that's something that I've learned. Well, I learned as a younger child, because I will say that what my father would do to get me to act right would be to give me stuff. So then once I didn't act right, I didn't get that stuff. So I learned early about, I guess, the value of money, and you can't place happiness on money. So the next says, he asked God to bless him and enlarge his territory. We do not know the reason why, but he requested this of God. But we do know that he was a man of honor. Thus, it's likely that he would only ask for something that he needed, and is equally likely that it would be used for more than his own personal gain. So basically, he asked something of God, and he was not considered a greedy person. So basically, whatever he asked of God is what he felt that he needed. His name means born in pain, and he was given that name by his mother, which in biblical times was custom. So a name was believed to represent the trademark character trait, the identity of the person bearing it. The meaning of the name was not a secret, so calling a person by their name also meant a particular thing was being spoken over them. So I think that's another thing, when people say, when people call you names, a lot of people associate that with it, whether it's the B word, the P word, like whatever. A name is what you give it. Like even the N word, whether it's the ER or the A, it still has a bad connotation. I say it, a lot of people say it, but they put the A on it to give it a better spin, but it's still one and the same. So it says, no matter what he did, when people spoke his name, he was reminded of his origin as a source of pain and suffering. So I would think as a child, it's hard for you to walk around with that name, especially, you know, nowadays. Now, I guess names do have meaning, but not like they did back in biblical times. So just imagine your mama naming you, you know, a source of pain. That's kind of traumatic. It's kind of traumatic. So it says, the second lesson is, you do not have to let the name or title someone has given you or your situation define who you are. So I know I started opening up about me suffering from depression. So had a conversation with my doctor, who I love. Like, I love my doctor. Like, it's been years since I had a doctor that actually, this is my primary care physician. it's been years since I had a doctor who I honestly felt like they cared about my well-being. And I think that's a good thing that I found her, but it's sad that I hadn't had one in a long time. Versus going to the doctor, being in the doctor for like 10 or 15 minutes, they get what they, you tell them, they, well, they rush through the list of things, blood pressure, temperature, did you cough, can you fart, you know, just the normal stuff that doctors ask you. But with her, like even our last video conversation is, I remember our past conversations, and that's considered bedside manner. So when I say that about depression, a lot of people say, you know, Carla, we always see you happy, we always see you laughing, we always see you playing. So they never feel like the quote unquote happy person has depressing moments. And I've had a lot of tragic events in my life, and it's called situational depression. And that's what my doctor was telling me. So she was like, well, Carla, I don't want you. And she is, I don't know what her ethnicity is. I can't remember what her ethnicity is, but she basically said how African Americans have a stigma attached to when they say about mental illness. And I feel like until we talk about it, it's not going to get better. And I'm a person that's pretty much open when it comes to that. I never want people to misunderstand, because you never know if that's going to be your last time talking to a person. But I never want someone to misunderstand something I say or my mood. So what I do is I will tell you, like, you know, today is not a good day. And I think that's something that we should be honest about instead of always saying I'm okay. I have started being comfortable with saying, you know, I'm not okay, I'm not fine. And I know that sounds awful, and I know they say speak stuff into existence, but you also have to get out your honest feelings. You really need to get out what's going on inside of you. So if you're not feeling it today, you need to tell somebody, like, I'm not feeling it, it's not a good day, so they won't misinterpret how you act toward them. Because, you know, if I don't tell a person, you know, I'm not having a good day, they'll just think like, well, what's wrong with Miss Carla? They call me Miss Carla at my other job, but what's wrong with Miss Carla? And I just let them know, you know, it's not a good day. And most of the time when you tell somebody it's not a good day, and there are people who really care about you and love you, they try to make your day better. I do notice that. So you are not depression. You are not fat. You are not ugly. You are not ignorant. You are not stupid. You are not any bad connotation that someone can give you. That's what you are not. So if you internalize stuff, and I also was watching Love Goals, and it was Spinderella and her boyfriend Q, and it just struck me as odd. And I was talking to my friend too, but in that situation, they had a compatibility test, and although they scored the lowest, Spinderella did not. She focused on the number, which is basically, in her head, that was the title. Like, that was the percentage of her love, but it wasn't the percentage of her love. So it doesn't matter what the number is, like even being fat, it don't matter what the scale is. How do you feel? What is your, not your number, how would you look that would make you feel comfortable? In your beauty, weave, no weave. Lashes, no lashes. Lip gloss, no lip gloss. Makeup, no makeup. Because it irritates me for when some people who are natural say, well, I'm all natural. All natural can be all ugly. Just like all makeup can be all ugly. It's how you say certain things. So, you know, I think it's just more so stop. That's another part of the comparison thing. So that drives me. So with that, it was, you do not have to let the name or title someone has given you to define who you are. Okay. The next one is, God is the ultimate definer and coordinator of your life and can change what may look like a curse into a blessing. God redefined the legacy of him to be what he had always planned on him becoming. Before this could happen, he had to ask for release from the mental, emotional, and social chains that were binding him. And people, my coworker was just telling me about this. People don't understand, but pretty much everything that we go through in life is actually in the Bible. So as you can see, it says mental, emotional, and social. So that's all of the things that we process today. I truly pray that God finds me faithful with all I have, that he releases me from pain, and that he enlarges my territory, not for my glory, but so I can continue to show others how great he is. And basically what she was saying was, she wants God to increase her territory, not for just for her to say, look at what I have, but also to show others, like, this is what God can gift you. So I hope you guys enjoyed day 4. It's a little late.
Father card, what day?
It's 9:00 and I said 7, but I had a lot of stuff to do. So I hope you guys enjoyed day 4. Have a great night, Humba.